Hello, hello. Are we ready to rock and roll? Okay, so I'm about to take you in a brief journey around the planet, just talking a little bit about guitars and different types of music. For the first piece I'm going to be doing is a classical piece. It's something I wrote a while back. It's called Paisaje Español, which means something like Spanish scenery. And it's something I wrote not in Spain, but outside in one of those trips when I was missing home. Thank you. Okay. So the story goes that the guitar traveled to many countries. One of them was Africa, in the western part of Africa. Okay, this used to happen by travelers. In Africa, for instance, was different European travelers that would go to Africa and take their guitars, and then just they would make some friends there, and they would leave their guitar there. Africans would do whatever they could to play them, you know, to learn their own way and try to play their own music. The next piece I'm doing is some music that comes from West Africa, and it's the music of the Mandinga, of the Jali people. The Jali people were in places like Mali, and Senegal, Gambia, etc. They were not really musicians, but they were storytellers. They were historians. They didn't have books, so they would go with their kora and their instruments, and they would play some rhythm, and they would start telling stories, okay? The next piece is like an air, a type of style that comes from Mali. And you can also find it in other places. Like, for instance, I used to play this piece in Senegal, and there they call this style Paja Paja. Thank you. So what happened is that in Africa there was many wars. There was tribal wars. There was also the colonizers taking Africans from their villages. And most of them, they were taken to West Africa, to actually Senegal, into a small island in front of the city of Dakar. In this island, they had a place where they would keep off these, all these people, now slaves. You still can go to this island nowadays, and you can see this place where they used to be, and you can meet what they call the door of no return, because that was the door by which all these Africans were taken to the ships and taken to the Americas. Now, in the Americas, they also got the guitar. And these Africans in North America, we all know they were slaves at the beginning, and they were working in cotton fields, in the building the railroad, etc. It was very interesting because they were slaves and they were not allowed to do anything except for working. But by providence or miracle or whatever, something happened, and is that the big bosses in the plantations, they noticed that when these Africans sing, they will work better. So one of the few things that was allowed to these people was to sing music and to do music. And that's how we got the blues, okay? Later on, back then they didn't have them, but later on this type of guitar came around the States thanks to the Piera brothers, some brothers that were coming from Eastern Europe, and you know, they copied this, the horn of the gramophone, they copied the idea and they built it on the guitar in order to make this a louder guitar, because back then there was not electric guitars yet, okay? So obviously, yeah, the next piece I'm gonna do is kind of blues. This is actually a working song kind of thing. It's instrumental, of course, but you will notice on the rhythm of the song that it's pretty much working song when somebody will be howling on the railroad and everybody will be hammering at the same time, okay?
Thank you.
Okay, so we're in the Americas, and the Africans got to all the Americans. They went to North America, Central America, South America, and they influenced a lot all the music in these places. In Central America, we can find many places with different styles like that. What I'm about to do is one style that comes from Cuba, from La Habana, the city of La Habana. There is a style called Habaneras. I'm choosing this piece actually because it has a very interesting story that is pretty much related to myself and my hometown. It happens that during the Cuban War for independence from Spain, many people in Spain were sent to Cuba to fight, okay? So everybody have to go to fight. So very few people would be exempt of that. In my hometown, there was one guy actually who, for certain reasons, which I don't know right now, he didn't have to go. He was a poor guy from a poor family, and at least he was lucky for that. But it happened that there was another family of rich people who had a son who has to go to war, to Cuba. And they actually offered money to this guy's family so he would go instead of the other guy. So obviously they were poor, so the guy said yes and went to Cuba to the war. Unfortunately, in a few days, he was lying at the hospital where he died. And some years later, one member of his family, he composed an habanera talking about, you know, the things that this man had went through in Cuba, you know, missing his hometown and wanted to go back to his town. And the habanera that I'm about to do is just an instrumental version of it. And it's called Volver a Egea, which means to return to Egea. Okay. So let's go to South America. South America is full of music and quite a lot of styles. And they already got the vihuela there and some string instruments before the guitar. So actually, when South Americans got the guitar, which was the Spanish guitar, they really did amazing things with it. And even nowadays, we know so little about South American music. For instance, let's say I take Argentina. We have so many folk styles like chacarera, like chamamé, like malambo, like samba. And the most famous ones are probably the tango from the city, you know, or the milonga. But for tonight, I'm actually going to do a tango. I know, I'm talking about the other styles, and then I do the tango. But anyway, this tango has a very interesting story. It's a piece I wrote some years ago based on two stories from Argentina that they were very meaningful to me. One was the story of the life of Piazzolla, wonderful composer, very famous now, but not at all when he was alive. Highly criticized, you know, because he was doing a lot of different things and changing things, you know, until he died, and they appreciate it, and we appreciate it. And there is another story in this tango, and it's the story of Malena. Malena was a singer, a tango singer, and one composer was so in love with this woman in her voice that he wrote up a song, a tango, called Malena. Even Malena herself, she used to sing this tango, not knowing that the tango was talking about herself. And it is said that one day she found out about this and she couldn't sing this tango anymore. So the piece I'm about to play, I call it Piazzolla Conoce a Malena, which means Piazzolla meets Malena. Thank you. Okay, so what happened then is that the Mexicans got to Hawaii and they took their guitars with them and they stayed there for a very short time and they left. But they gave their friends the Hawaiians friends, the guitars. The Hawaiians didn't know what to do with the guitar. First thing they did was to retune it, actually. They took the Spanish guitar and they were doing like this. It didn't sound like anything pleasant. So they start doing what they call in Hawaiian kihoalu, which is slackening the keys, like retuning until they got something a little nicer, yeah? And that's how they have the slacky or the kihoalu guitar, which was just a normal Spanish guitar, acoustic, and they would just play regularly. But then came Joseph Kekuku, who, by providence, slid an object on the strings of the guitar and got this wonderful sound. And that's how, that was the beginning of what they call the kikakila, or a steel guitar in Hawaiian, yeah? The next piece I'm gonna do is a Hawaiian piece I wrote. I played it actually on this same place last year. It's a piece dedicated to the last queen of Hawaii. For those who don't know, the Hawaii was taken by foreigners and their last queen was put on house arrest and she spent the rest of her years composing music at home. And she was the one that wrote the famous Aloha Oe, the anthem of Hawaii, and many other songs that are still playing Hawaii. So, this is a piece I personally composed in memory of this wonderful queen that was called Liliuokalani. Thank you. All right, so this steel guitar thing became like a fever, actually. Hawaiians went all around the world, actually. They were touring in the States, and actually bluesmen in the south states of the States, they were getting influenced by Hawaiian troops. You know, they were seeing how the Hawaiians would slide their theme, and they started doing the same thing with like a bottleneck, you know, like I did before on the other guitar. They just took bottlenecks and started sliding too and playing blues. But there was other people who were the Irish people that were going to the States. They were running away from home. They have the famous potato famine, you know, where people was dying. So they have to leave their country and look for a better place. They end up in the States, and there they brought their Celtic music, their Irish music, and things start mixing there, you know? Their way of playing, their music, and also the sounds of the blues, the touch of the Hawaiian guitar, and many other things, and that's how we got the country music, and later the bluegrass. The next piece is just like a country dance, I call it.
Thank you.
Okay, but let's move away from the Americas and let's go to the Far East. Let's go to China. Actually, China is an special case, you know, a case where they have guitars, but they didn't try to play their own music with the guitars. Some people tried a little bit, but it didn't become like a tradition or anything like that, yeah? When you go to China, people take maybe the Spanish guitar and learn classical guitar or even flamenco or the electric guitar, etc. But funnily enough, they have some wonderful instruments that lend themselves very well to be played on the guitar. For instance, there is an instrument called the pipa, which is very similar to a guitar. It's like a lute with four strings, played vertical like this. And the music for this instrument is amazing on the guitar. There is another called the guqin, which is one of the eldest instruments in the world still in use today. And it's very similar to a steel guitar. You know, it's kind of like a mixture between a steel guitar and a fretless guitar played on your lap. But what I'm about to do now is a traditional piece, which originally is more for pipa, for the first instrument that I said. Now, sometimes with the musics that come from the Far East are a little bit difficult to understand or to listen. Just to give you an idea, Chinese people, they're pretty much following, at least on the traditional music and beliefs, they're following a lot nature. You know, and when they make music, for instance, a lot of things are trying to represent the elements from nature, okay? So, let's see what you hear on this tune. This is called the Yi people. It's a traditional melody from the Yi people in the Western China region. Thank you. All right. So more Eastern stuff. This time let's go to India. It's very interesting, this relation between India and the Hawaiian guitar. There are many stories of how the Hawaiian guitar came up to be, you know, the one of Jose Kekuku sliding the thing on the guitar. And there is another one that tells the story about the Portuguese sailors that used to go to India too. They kidnap a little kid and they drop the kid in Hawaii. Now in India, there is an instrument called the veena, which is basically like two guards, one a stick and the strings. And you take like an object like a polished rock or something similar, and you slide it on the strings, just like a Hawaiian guitar. So almost everybody in India knows this instrument because it's the instrument that actually the goddess Sarasvati, which is the goddess of culture, music, and arts, this goddess is always pictured holding this instrument. So there is another story going around that says that maybe this Joseph Kekuku in Hawaii saw this Indian kid taking a guitar and trying to play like a veena. The truth we will never know. But thank God, or thank gods and goddesses, for the guitar, the Hawaiian guitar, the Indian guitar, and all the guitars. So now what happened later on, in the golden years of the Hawaiian music, they were touring all over the world. And there was a troupe of Hawaiians who were actually playing some concerts in India. Because of the World War and Pearl Harbor in Hawaii, they couldn't go back home and they have to stay for a long time there. So many Indians got exposed to the Hawaiian guitar and the way you play it. It happens also in India that many travelers, in this case, it is said that it was a German traveler who was going there with his guitar. Gave it to a friend in India, and this friend wanted to play guitar, but he wanted to play Indian music. So he took the guitar and he started playing it like the Hawaiian style. And little by little, he started adding different strings, you know, besides the normal strings, he would just put these strings here that we call chicory and drum, and this star up here. And that's how we got the Indian guitar. Okay. So I'm gonna play a light composition. It's something I wrote when I was living in India, studying there. I heard this bhajan, which is like a devotional song. Okay, and I liked it so much that I wanted to write something like that on the same raga and with a similar flavor. And this is what it came up. It's a piece called Bageshri, which is the name of the Indian raga. It's something like, you know, longing, you know, when you're away from somebody or you know, missing someone or something. So that's kind of like what this raga means. Thank you. We're getting home. So, up to this point, we're getting into the Middle East. And the Middle East is quite interesting for music because they have a lot of notes and sounds that we don't have in the West. We refer here to these sounds like microtones and quarter tones and things like that, you know. So the guitar actually got to the Middle East, especially, for instance, in Turkey. There is a big tradition of playing the guitar, actually playing a fretless guitar, you know. In that way, they can get all these notes that they use. Unfortunately, today I don't have a fretless guitar, but I do have a little invention that I made in order to play this music, which is just simply changing my tuning a little bit so I could get these extra notes. So you hear these notes here, like it's kind of out of tune, yeah? So for people from the West, this is the most difficult thing. When you get there, you hear these notes and it's like, wow, it's so ugly at the beginning. But as your ears open up, these are actually the sweetest notes that you can hear on this music. So anyway, let's give it a try. This is a traditional piece from Turkey. It's called Yali Kenari, and it's based on what they call their makam, which is called Hüseyini. Thank you. every time there is less to choose, yeah. So, since we're in the Middle East and talking about the East, etc., there is the story of those that people that came from Western India, from the Thar Desert, places like Rajasthan, and then going towards Pakistan and all these places, yeah. These were some tribes still there nowadays called Mangas and Manganillas and Langas and Kalbiliars. These people started traveling west, and they migrated to all different countries. They went to Pakistan, Afghanistan, they passed through Iran. They went even all the way to Egypt and Turkey, and they went through the north of the Mediterranean, in Eastern Europe, and even to France. Actually, in Europe, we started calling them the Gypsies. And they created a lot of music along the way. And many of these countries, they created their own music with what they were bringing and what they found, and they have styles all over. For instance, the next example is a piece of a style called jazz manouche, which is like gypsy jazz, and it comes from the gypsies in France. Thank you. And this is the end. So these gypsies also got to Spain. And that's how we got the flamenco in Spain. It's been a pleasure to be here and have all of you here. I hope you enjoyed this trip. I'm gonna leave you with some flamenco, and this is gonna be a palo, a style in the flamenco called tangos. Since we're here in Germany, in all this event organized by our good friend Michael Gotz, I will play his wonderful guitar. So I'm gonna do a piece I wrote, I don't even remember when, but a long time ago. I think like you start traveling to many places and you know, you stay there for a while, you make friends, and then you go somewhere, you make friends, and then you go somewhere and you make friends, and sometimes you are able to keep in touch and see your friends again, some other times you don't. So this is a piece I wrote thinking about all these people I meet everywhere. So it's dedicated to all of them, and of course all of you. So it's a piece that is actually called Friends. And well, thank you very much again.